create your own private network within your community. People get to know each other, they have their own social kind of media between each other. So people have met and kind of dated through it. They share knowledge, they share in places where bus times are irregular, they share these things. So people become informed, oh, okay, so bus is a bit delayed, rather than relying on decentralized figures or hoping that the community governance looks after them. As a huge move forward, because again, you're looking at it from a peer-to-peer perspective, I look at it from a peer-to-peer perspective, and it allows people to connect with each other, share information, on a way without needing to, I guess, look to the authority of the commission, you know. You kind of bypass that. At the same time, you create networks that cannot be spied on unless you're directly in the network or physically close enough to be able to access it. So it has huge benefits in terms of security and privacy. And yeah, lots of other things that you can see there. So this was another project that I actually personally went and visited in Barcelona just to get an idea of what's happening. So in Spain I was told there are over 3,000 abandoned they say abandoned villages, but pretty much what happened, for example, with the one I went to, there used to be about 5,000 people living there. And throughout time, because, you know, I guess the younger generation wants to move closer to the city, they leave and these numbers drop down to about 1,000. So the community is really in fear of being completely abandoned and the community just dying out. So they're looking for ways to kind of introduce people back into it. You know, they have good supporting system for themselves, so they have oil production, they turn into oil, they have events around that. They have their own economy kind of going, but they want more people to come in. So these people have gone in and kind of found space, and there's fiber optic internet there, so it's quite remarkable. And yeah, they just kind of want people to kind of live there if you want to live off the grid, if you want to co-work there, co-living. And yeah, I went with them, and this is one of the other farms we went to. Actually, these couple were amazing. They're from Bitterman as web designers, and they kind of like got their money together and came to Spain and drove around in the caravan that's there for like 3 months or something looking for land. And then they bought this land, and it was like very hectic, and then they kind of cut it all back, made it really nice, built the house together, and now they just live off there. And you know, they get the olive trees that are like 200-300 years old, and they kind of like they learned how to, through their own teaching, how to press the olive oil and kind of sell it, and they're happy with it. I thought it was really, really inspiring. You know, they just kind of like committed together to kind of overtake their national boundaries. This is a video I want to show you just quickly. And this was Trust in Digital World in the Ministry of Economics in Den Haag in the Netherlands. And yeah, I think it speaks for itself, because I was really surprised. As you know, these women to be very corporate figures, people who should be quite knowledgeable in the public. And the comments they made, I guess I won't comment on it, but just see what you think. I'm quite curious from your perspective. And I just want to skip the first part. So, just to, before I started, he was arguing that Bitcoin is a very elitist thing, so it's owned by a few people and it's...
Would you want to join it?
I thought it would be different, you know. And I was really shocked by the comments that were being brought up. And another point that really disappointed me, I went to the European Union in Brussels for an event they had blockchain for social goods. So they were trying to see how blockchain can affect society and how they can kind of learn from it. And, you know, I don't mean to downplay their part or speak negatively of them, but I found it really strange that they kind of had no idea what's going on. You know, the comments they made really show that they had no idea what blockchain is. They had no idea. And they were, for me, I felt like they were really scared, you know, and they had asked all these industry specialists to come out and kind of teach them, hey, what's going on? Should people worry? And one guy in particular I found really interesting because he kept asserting his desire to kind of control it. It's like, oh, if people think Bitcoin is going to continue the way it is, they're kidding themselves, you know. It's definitely going to, you know, we're going to find ways to regulate it and stop it. You know, my comment to him was, you know, as a representative of the people, and you're being paid by the people, and why aren't you trying to see why people want this change and try and help them and try and educate them rather than keep asserting your power as though it's about the power and the power you guys have. And yeah, you get your political politician answer, which is kind of just diluted into words and I don't know what he said. But yeah, it was just quite interesting and disappointing at the same time because yeah, I had expected a bit more from them by now. So yeah. But yeah, so that kind of goes over what I wanted to speak to you about, kind of different projects that I found really interesting that show the application of blockchain technology far beyond the financial application. Things that can really improve our lives, you know, from Bitcoin to storage, the nation. These projects have really utilized the application of blockchain and put it to good use. And I've seen a lot more come up, you know. Really grateful for the amount of people that have come to this event, and I'm really grateful for the mindset of people. And I've seen a great progression since last year to today. That's been one year, and people that can still really use Bitcoin and pay for things, no longer a confusion. And I'm really happy about the topic of Bitcoin that I used to speak to people about, and I had no idea what it was. And now these people kind of are starting to understand it. But I just hope it goes in the right way. I hope it doesn't fall into the wrong hands and people kind of follow the wrong path. And yeah, we continue to see a lot more projects come up and the development of it. And one thing Andreas said that I find really, really powerful is that any problems you see with blockchain, any problems you see with blockchain technology, any problems you see with Bitcoin, any other cryptocurrency, is a business idea. So if you see a problem, you can automatically find a solution for it, and that in itself could be a business establishment or a startup. And that's really exciting because, you know, the problems can suddenly become opportunities for people to work. And yeah, that's about it. Sorry if went over a lot of different aspects. But yeah, hope you enjoyed it, hope you can take something from it. Cheers for listening.
Alright, so now we'll have a brief Q&A. And so, if anybody has any questions, raise your hand.
I have one question. If you're familiar with I heard that the Mayor of Barcelona, Ada Colau, like wanted to introduce some cryptocurrency to kind of parallel to like a existing banking system. And have you heard something about that?
No, sorry, can you please repeat the first part?
Mayor of Barcelona, Ada Colau, yeah, she's like she's been occupying banks, you know, and like protesting a lot, you know. And then when she became a mayor, she wanted to introduce some cryptocurrency for Barcelona, citizens of Barcelona.
Yeah, I haven't heard about that at all, but I'm interested in the topic.
Yeah. Okay. That's
sorry.
Okay.
I haven't heard about it.
Okay, and can, if there isn't some other question,
yeah,
have another one.
Go for it.
When you kind of mentioned something like this one slide, minimal basic income and decentralized environment, do you have some ideas how to solve the problem with proof of individuality on decentralized environment?
Yeah, so one of the guys was actually working with Ethereum, one of the Ethereum developers, and they came up with this principle of individuality, which was the concept was, for example, when you have a webcam session or, you know, an online conference, you have the four screens kind of, if you have four people. So the proof of individuality in that case would be like, you know someone that knows someone, if they can attend a web call, they can prove from one aspect that that is you. And then they want to incorporate this into other parts as well. That was just an initial idea. With the basic income, we actually implemented it for ourselves. So we have an idea of taking, for example, the debit cards that we provide to the citizens on the website, or the world ID that we want to issue, which you can print or do through the website as well. So we wanted to take the, you know, the small amount of profit that comes through and distribute that with the people that have developed the nation. So, you know, the 14 or 15 people that have kind of put a lot of work for, they wanted to create a basic income system. So the profit that comes through these sales can distribute itself amongst the members. And we've set that up. And it's done on Ethereum. It's really, really interesting because, you know, all you have to do is just send the Ethereum tokens, just address it, automatically gets distributed amongst the members that have been added. And all members can kind of vote, gets added or removed. And it's a completely decentralized way of approaching profit sharing. And we want to also do this for the 4,000 plus members that we have. So any other donation we have, any other systems of money that comes through, to be able to distribute this amongst the citizens. Yeah, so those are the kind of things we're working on, and we hope to kind of test them and see where it goes. But I think in terms of like the profit sharing through Ethereum, for the organization itself, we'll be the first one to do that. And I really like the concept.
And how to avoid this kind of improve individuality. If people who know each other kind of are proving their individuality, then they can like fake that they're like two persons. Like, so they, I mean, someone can misuse that they're kind of two persons, kind of double individuality.
Yeah. Well, you have to work on the trial and error. I mean, like when the DAO came out, people invested in $100 million into it, and then looked where it went. And then what that taught everyone so many great lessons. But with the same thing, we have to try it, we have to see how it works, and then, you know, from there kind of improve on it. And, you know, we're hoping other platforms such as Identify or something like that, would have developed further by now, that we could have used it, and there's a lot of happening. I mean, at the heart of the entire online system lies the reputation. Without the reputation system, a lot of things are not possible to be done. You know, it's really, really important that we have a good online reputation system. So yeah, we have to try and error, and we have to figure out, you know, if there's two that we can kind of cheat it, obviously we'd have to improve it and figure out different ways.
Okay, another question here. Thank you for the very interesting presentation, and I have one question. The slide about the donation, I see the information about the world ID. Can you go explain this?
Sure. Let me just bring it up. So the world ID goes on the concept of self-determination. So by international law, you have the ability to choose for yourself what kind of system you want to follow, what kind of system you want to deal or deals to, even if it's your own rules, even if it's your own self-system. And this is what gives nations their power. There's nothing more than that. You know, there's nothing beyond that. So when you live in a country and they assume, what gives them the power is that they assume you have chosen them as their rightful leader. So we're kind of taking the same concept and said, all right, so we can issue IDs following the same standards, international laws, and furthermore follow the European Union laws and issue the IDs based on those. And we actually have one of our members and ambassadors in Sweden who did this, and is able to use that ID now to purchase things, to prove that he's over 18, and prove his identity, even if he's at the pharmacy. And I think that's a great, you know, step forward. It's not a huge movement, but it's still something to consider, something to show, okay, we can test the water with this, and where else can we use it? And in our idea, we believe it should be able to be used within the Schengen area, as long as we follow the kind of set of rules or, yeah, that they kind of apply to us. And from there, we kind of want to implement ID cards that have the NFC chips, so then we can link it back, I guess, to the basic income program, we can link it back to the citizenship on the website, but do it in a way that's encrypted, obviously. We don't want any biometrics of people stored, we don't want any of these things. And yeah, I think that would be a kind of really cool step forward. We have ID system linked to Bitcoin wallet, basic income, and even linked to the Pangea system. That would be quite remarkable. And we're also working on a BitNation ID, so instead of signing in using, I guess, Facebook or Google or something like that, you can use a blockchain address. like Bitcoin address or something like that to sign in. So further improving the anonymity of the user and the security of the user. I hope that answers it.
Thank you.
Okay, any more questions?
Hi, thanks for the speech. I was curious about that community in Spain.
Yeah.
Do you have some link or contact to more information about that?
Yeah, of course. So it's Pandora Hub, and I can afterwards just give you the link.
Okay.
And we can put you in touch with the person that kind of started. But it's really, it was a really good experience for me. I was only there for like 2 days, but it seemed like something that's starting up, but I'm sure over time they'll improve as you kind of really get the hang of it, you know, and we'll see more and more of these. I mean, there's 3,000 out of the abandoned buildings in Spain alone, and in France as well, there's a lot. So it's really cool to see the space that's starting to be used. And it'll be even further nice to kind of see them work with the nation and kind of see what we can do as a community. But yeah, it's cool.
Okay. Final thoughts?
Cheers. Thank you.
Okay.